あるとマイクみたいになりたい。でも電話してくれない。オークランドとブックレンドから世界チャンピオン、バーチャルプローズ始まるよ。よよよよよよよよよ。バーチャルプローズ。To my motherfucking man, 50 grand, an alcoholic man, and jack a tall can in his bloodstream if he can. Biggie Smalls, the 50 stroker, MC provoker, chocolate tie smoker, huh? I like to max and maximas and Acuras. Your girl butt cheeks, I'm smacking, huh? The raw rapper, spine snapper, with the little cuz on my lap. I like to play the max. The ball, I ain't your fucking comforter. And if I ever fall in love, I bet I'm fucking up.
Damn, I haven't done this in a fucking while. This is episode 123 of that World Champion Sound Virtual Pros podcast. My name is Al, and with me, my main oos, Mike.
Hey, what's up, motherfuckers? This is Mike. Happy 2021.
Today's topic, the 2020 Virtual Pros Year-End Awards. We look at the weirdest year of wrestling ever and hand out trophies to the heroes that deserve it. Hit us on Twitter and Instagram at VRTLPros. Hit us on iTunes, on Spotify. Talk to us on Discord. If you want to participate, email us at virtualpros64@gmail.com. Mike, we have a good amount of emails in the mailbox. You mind starting off with that first one?
Sure. I also think we may have at least one question in the Discord, too. It's going to be filled with topics. So first email's from Tim. It's crossovers. What's up, Big Perms? Going to make this bad boy short and sweet. Now that the big bad Kenny Omega-san has been going around AAA and shitty-ass Impact, who are your dream crossover matches? We all seen the Hulkster New Japan clothes lining Inoki-san. But what are your dream-style crossovers in the history of Prodis? I'm talking about Crash Holly versus Prime backbreaking Roddy, or Jacqueline against any real ass women's wrestlers, preferably Madison fucking Eagles. Tim Sanchez, aka Cash LaRue, aka Limp Bizkit, made red hats shitty 20 years ago. I agree with that. Aka New York 20 by 20. You couldn't measure my ring with six rulers. I never think of wrestling in this kind of capacity of people from the past that could wrestle. I think maybe, like, I'm sure, and the thing, I think in, at least, I mean, I guess it's the same in America, where a lot of these people probably have wrestled at some point, and it just wasn't popular. But, like, I would pick somebody like Prime Shibata versus Prime Shinjiro Otani or something like that. And I bet, you know, I bet at one point they have wrestled, and it wasn't probably a big deal, because it was probably just some throwaway match, but yeah, something like that. I'm not very imaginative when it comes to shit like this.
I got one answer and one answer only, and that is a Prime Aja Kong versus a Prime Sasha Banks, which I guess is right now for Sasha Banks. I can't imagine how hard Sasha Banks would crave death when facing an early 90s Aja Kong. That'd be pretty sweet. Where the hell did I had to search for that in the inbox. Okay. Next email is from Justin, titled Dream 4K Walking Tours. I like where this is going. What up, Z Gangsters? I recently started getting into YouTube virtual walking tours heavily, and I watched them on mute while listening to podcasts. The other day, I started thinking about what wild shit you would see on a wrestling version of a walking tour through an IWA MS show during the pandemic, or the Zona 23 junkyard during a show. What 4K walking tour of a wrestling event, a store, or dojo would you want to see? Thanks for all the great shows through the pandemic. You held up better than wrestling did. Peace. Damn, Justin, thank you very much. That means a lot. I mean, I guess my teenage dream one would be like going through the ECW arena, just because, you know, that's a place I've never visited, and I guess that's one of the hallmarks when it comes to American pro wrestling, in terms of like venues, the Stardom locker room, obviously. Just kidding. An event? Yeah, any kind of crazy death match, like Zona 23 would be pretty nuts, I bet. I guess those are my three answers.
Yeah, I forgot that I skimmed this email when he wrote it. We got it like last month, and I gotta check these these YouTube virtual walking tours, because this is definitely a corner of YouTube I've never seen before, and it sounds pretty interesting. I'd like to look it up.
Yo, Justin, make us a playlist on on walking tours that we need to peep. I'm interested.
I think it would be some of the weirder Mexican venues, probably, because they seem a little wild. Like, obviously, Zona 23 does a good job of feeling like a walking tour anyways, because they use, like, those 4K cameras, and they're kind of just guys going through the crowd most of the time. So it kind of feels like you're there. But there's a lot of other of those, like, I mean, I'm so bad at venue names, but there's many, lesser-known Mexican venues that I see over and over again where I'm just like, holy shit, man, like, it would be so cool to go here. So I think walking tours, like, places like that and the areas they're around would probably be my answers. Because they have, like, a lot of arenas that were just made for boxing and wrestling, and those seem to be the cooler ones. Next email. Is this? Yes. Yes, okay. It's next email's from Eric. Favorite wrestling Santa moments. This was before Christmas, so, you know. I know it seems like a lifetime ago, but hello, pros. Wait, didn't we read this? Maybe. Oh, no. He was responding to from last episode. Hello, pros. My favorite wrestling Santa moment happened in 2018 at my local promotion, Empire State Wrestling, at their biggest show of the year, Wrestle Bash. They always have some surprises lined up at Wrestle Bash, and that year one of the surprises was a trio of wrestling Santas made up of Puff, Super Cop, Dick Justice, and Space Monkey, fighting the trio of Roscoe Black, RJ City, and Gregory Iron. Gregory Iron stole the win at the end and caught a beatdown from the Santas that ended up with him getting powerbombed onto a pile of candy canes. What made this so special was who Gregory Iron is. For those who don't know, he has cerebral palsy, which gives him a very limited use of his right hand. But instead of being a sympathetic, inspirational hero, he's a chicken shit heel who constantly cheats. So we get treated to a magical Christmas moment where three Santas beat up a disabled man until he had to be helped out of the ring, to cheers and laughter from all who attended the show. Merry Christmas, pro wrestling never change, Eric. I have no real comments to add to that. Outside of, I was a big fan of Dick Justice, and I think he's retired from wrestling, whatever that means. But I think he's moved on. But it sucked. He never really got his due, I don't think, as we approach the age of the meme wrestler, where a lot of wrestlers are just kind of memes on the internet. He could have fit in there, and it kind of sucks that he didn't really get his due.
I was going to ask what happened to Dick Justice. I don't hear that name anymore, and you answered it for me. But Eric, you can just keep this between, you know, you and I. Did you ever chant ESW at this show? Just be honest. Next email is from Cole, titled
Greater Power Reveal. Oh, you missed one.
Wait, what's up?
You missed one.
Okay, wait.
Anthony? Yep.
My bad, Anthony. This is for me specifically. Titled VRTL CRDS. I like it. Hey, card bags. How's it going? Wondering if you guys, particularly Al, have delved into the New Japan Collection's card trading app at all. It's scratching my card itch pretty well, but I'm guessing maybe it's not replicating that real rip enough for you. Stay safe, mates. I can't do it, Anthony. Like, I just imagine just, like, buying JPEGs when it comes to virtual cards. I know, like, Panini, like, they're trying to usher in this era of, like, blockchains and like, trading and buying virtual cards, quote-unquote. But, like, I just don't get it. Like, it's above my head. I'll sell them all day long, but, like, in terms of, like, getting that same feeling of ripping something tangible, like, I don't think it could ever match it for me personally.
I think there's a proper way of doing the digital card things, and I don't think New Japan does a very good job at it at all. I downloaded that when it first came out, and it's just like, it looks like it's from 2009. It looks like it's from, like, the iPhone Touch, like one of the first apps you would download on the Touch. And New Japan has a wealth of wrestlers. They've been around since 1972, and it was just kind of like the current wrestlers, and it's like, damn, man, like, you could have thousands and thousands of cards in your app already because you have such a rich history of wrestlers, and it's just like these current dudes, and I don't fucking care. And I don't know. There's no appeal to that to me either. It's a decent idea, but they just needed to add variety to it, and I wasn't into it.
Have you seen this new grift by the NBA where you can just buy video clips of like very specific like moments, like LeBron swatting Iguodala, and people are paying like $40,000 for this shit?
That's, I don't know what it's like. It's an app.
It's called Top Shot. Check it out. It's pretty fucking wild. This is like one of the best grifts I've seen so far on the internet. Like, I will just watch YouTube. Like, you don't own that, man. It's insane what people are paying. Nothing.
I saw they kind of they used to have, well, I mean, they still have it. They had like an app that went with the NBA 2K game that had like a little card game inside of that. And I think they kind of made it its own thing now. And there's games like that where I'm like, this is kind of cool because you're like collecting cards and they have sort of a purpose. It's just not for me. I saw an ad in my Instagram for like, you know, like a digital hockey version of that. And they have like relic cards, which just like replicate like cards that have like, you know, like a jersey in them. And it's just like, wow, that's fucking weird. Like, that's not a thing you can really replicate. That's so odd. That's like defeating the purpose. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, people are into it, I guess. But it's just weird. Next email is from Cole. Greater power reveal. Hey, pros. Figured 2021 was a good time as any to finally out myself for one of the greatest unsolved mysteries of the podcast. Who leaked your shit talking to Chip Fiend Fred Benson? It was me. I have no regrets. Nothing gross about pushing one's limits with some of the tastiest and hottest snacks known to man, though some health concerns have pushed him more in the direction of healthy whole meals. He's quarantining and doing his best to keep his mask on and is in good care. Attached is a portrait of AWA-era glam Road Warriors I had him do after Animal's passing. Still a fan of the pod, but know I will always be listening to make sure you don't shit-talk my boy. P.S. I reported Wrestling Otaku to Target Corporate for a video he had about not being able to keep his hands off his boss's butt. Maybe this could be a cool movement we start because that's terrifying and they didn't seem to care. Wow. Cole, a.k.a. WWP Pooserweight Champion Piss Chair of Flow. Man, Cole, you should make the Hangry Dolls because you got a good one. A.k.a. APW Lay Conservative Shithead Piss Chair of Poo.
I'm fucking crying. This guy said piss chair of flow.
Then he included the picture from Fred Benson. That's good to know that it was Cole that rat us out. I'm glad you still listen. And I mean, I'm glad it's still one of my favorite moments of the podcast. I'm glad you ratted us out. I think Wrestling Otaku did probably. I think he got fired from Target. So I think maybe your email helped that. So don't feel like it was for nothing. But yeah, great email, Cole. I'm glad you still listen.
Dude, I remember exactly where I was when that thing happened. I was at Target at Starbucks with a coworker, and she was getting the unicorn drink, which looked obscene. But I remember just feeling really bad because it's my voice making fun of how he was eating. And like, it really was like a come to Jesus moment where I was like, man, my words have power. And maybe this guy did feel really bad about me making fun of him. So I did feel sincerely bad about making fun of Fred. I mean, we even sent him snacks afterwards just to, you know, extend the olive branch. So, you know what, Cole, thank you for that. And also, Piss Jeriflo legit made me cry just now. That was fucking incredible. If I can laugh like that every day.
I forgot to mention, I had a buy. I don't know. Yeah, it was the last episode we did was the thing. So I bought the WWP. It came, and I made a video on our Twitter of operating, and I fucked it up. I did it wrong. But it does poop slime. And then I had to, my girlfriend came home and she saw like the stuff left over. And she's like, what the fuck is this? And I was just like, I told her and she's like, you did this without me? And I was just like, I didn't think you would care. She's like, this sounds so cool. So I had to buy another one, which was, it wasn't WWP. It was, there's a DJ for teens named DJ Marshmallow or something like that. And it was a ripoff of him and it was named DJ Fartmallow. And so I had to do it with a DJ Fartmallow character, and he had glitter poop, so it was pretty cool. But yeah, those dolls, they give you one chance, and that's it. They don't sell refills or nothing. It's I could see why they didn't catch on.
Next email is from Uncle Franklin, titled TNA Death Ham. What's up, guys? It's Island Franklin. I know at times it seems like we record these podcasts for nobody, but trust me, I'm listening and love it. So does that cuck Bert. You guys are the draw, and I want to thank you for putting out the second best wrestling podcast. I have to say second because there's magic being made in a compound in Corpus Christi. You know, my brain is so broken. I get that. Inside joke, and I've never listened to it, Mike, so thanks for that. All right, so listen up. You remember when a wrestler would die and TNA would send the family a ham? The death hams were real, right? I don't know if it was something real or if I fell victim to what's known as the Mandela effect. Wait. Okay, let me repeat this. I don't want to fuck your joke up, Franklin. I don't know if it was something real or if I'd fell victim to what's known as the Mandela effect, named after Howie Mandel and people thinking he had a Jerry curl when he's always been bald. Next, let's say you get free passes to the Jericho Cruise. Free travel to board, free everything. What's it take for you, Al, and Rich Mike to hop aboard? Is free not enough? Fine. What if you get a grand each? What are you doing the 3 days there? Playing slots with good old JR? Maybe you can recommend some IG follows. Rocking out in the jacuzzi with, is that wealth? Or just too sweeting everyone on deck? I know Al will be doing DDP yoga first thing in the morning, but what else is on the agenda? Thanks, guys. Sincerely, Island Franklin. Plug my podcast, you bozos, and lie to them and say it's good. Yeah, check out Uncle to Uncle. It's the only podcast I know that's recorded on a king-size bed shared by two men. It's pretty
two
funny.
Uncles.
It makes me laugh.
Just not any men. Two uncles.
Two uncles. My fault. $1,000 is not enough to get on any cruise. Like I've always been anti-cruise. I always just felt like it just wasn't for me. Like I would want to walk around on vacation, and like having to walk around the deck like X amount of times doesn't seem that appealing. Like I always hear about people catching diseases. I mean, obviously like late with everything going on in the world, but even before then, like, I don't know. It just seems like a fucked up time to spend my vacation. So you could never get me on the Jericho Cruise, especially with wrestling fans. Get the fuck out of here. No way, dude. You couldn't give me 10 grand. I still wouldn't go.
Yeah, I know Franklin is a big fan of the malls, but I think it would just be like being on a mall. You can't leave for days.
Yeah,
and true. That sounds horrible. It sounds like a nightmare. I don't know why people do this shit. It's very expensive, I think, too. I mean, even if you're paying, though, it's still like I would just stay in my room the whole time. I would maybe go out at like 3 a.m. when no one else was out or something like that, just to get out. But yeah, it sounds like a terrible way to spend even a day, no less five. So I don't know how people do that shit.
And the internet is trash, dude. There's no fucking way I could do it for more than 5 days. No, not at all. But do you have any insight on this death ham? Because I haven't heard about that thing at all.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about the first half. I remember I thought it was Green Lantern fan that sent the ham to Chris Candido's family. Chris Candido's family when he died. It was Green Lantern fan. I didn't know it was TNA. I think Franklin is remembering it wrong. And the rumor was that it was Green Lantern fan sending hams to deceased wrestlers. But anybody who was around back then, I know the DVD-VR guys might know what we're talking about. So maybe somebody else can clarify this, but I'm pretty sure the rumor was always Green Lantern fan was sending hams. But yes, hopefully somebody can clarify. Next email is from Daniel. It's titled Zucchini. Happy. Oh, it's the last email too, and I think there's some Discord. But Zucchini, Happy New Year, Vert Bags. Here's to the last episode of the Trump presidency. Plays YGFDT, loud as hell. A couple scattered thoughts. I got a subscription box of fruit and veg that's not considered pretty enough for supermarket shelves, and there's always one veg I hate. We call it courgette. Y'all call it zucchini. Man, fuck this vegetable. The only way to make it worthwhile is to dump an udder's worth of cheese on it. Please speak your mind on zucchini and the bitch-ass vegetable that it is. Anyways, I haven't seen much wrestling since Wrestle Kingdom, but I'd like to know what you felt was the most disgusting promotional tactic of 2020, as per the Observer Awards. So many to count, but Matt Riddle's real-life cheating being used as a background to sauce up a TV match with Baron Corbin is up there, because that real-life occurrence comes with severe accusations of assault made towards Riddle. So gross, wrestling sucks. Anyway, shout out to the Discord, Black Lives Matter, lots of love, Daniel from London. P.S. bonus shout out to Aya for the amazing art, getting her work framed as a late Christmas gift. I don't have any problems with zucchini. I didn't know people from England had a different name for it. I don't know what that's all about. I don't love zucchini. I think it's, you know, if you're watching your carbs, you can make something called zoodles out of them, which is noodles, zucchini shaped in the form of noodles because you shave them. I don't think I've ever had a ton of cheese on zucchini. I don't think I've ever eaten it that way. That sounds like a child thing to do or something. I don't know.
Like fucking ants on a log.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I'm not eating fucking zucchini every day, but when I do, I don't put cheese on it. But yeah, I have no problem with it. I think there's much worse vegetables out there. I don't think it's in top tier or anything, but you could do worse. I fucking hate beets. I don't ever want to eat those. You know, celery, I'll eat it, but it's not great. You know, there's shit out there that's worse than zucchini.
Yeah, you're tripping, Daniel. Like, zucchini's fine. Like, zoodles are cool. And I also have had it with, like, shaved Parmesan cheese on top. That's fine, too.
Oh, maybe he means, if he means Parmesan, I get it. I'm thinking he's, like, putting, like, the shredded Mexican blend Kraft cheese on it and, like, melting it like it's a fucking pizza bagel or something in the microwave.
Yeah, I was thinking that you were thinking that, like, Dan was, like, just eating these things, like, wrapped up in a Kraft single or something, yeah. Like a five-year-old, but I don't think he's doing that.
Yeah, but it's just shaved Parmesan, okay? I get it. I'm sorry for making fun of you, Daniel. I wasn't really thinking.
Yeah, it's fine. I don't have anything off top for a gross promotional tactic.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that part. I mean, to me, it's just
indie wrestling in general. Yeah, that's my answer, I suppose.
That's my answer, too. It's just very bad. Very bad of trying to push people into giving, like, money, and I don't know. It's just real gross. Yeah, the Discord. Let's see. Human ravioli. Did you ask two in a row? What's going on here? Oh, no, this one's from October. Okay, yeah, December. Hey, pros, what booking decisions have led to near complete disinterest in New Japan after the G1? Or do you think it's normal G1 seasonal burnout? Also, do you think Jim Cornette would enjoy a Time Bomb Pro show as much as Time Bomb Pro likes the Jim Cornette show? Nick, a.k.a. High Work Rate Card Pro, a.k.a. for all you women out there, if you're hoping to get with a wrestling otaku, if you're hoping to do that with the wrestling otaku, you better be ready to do some work, bitch. Wrestling otaku, popular topic for this episode. The great thing about this question is that Time Bomb, the aforementioned Time Bomb Pro, somehow invited a wrestler named Neil Diamond Cutter to our Discord, and he answered this as if this question was for him, which is real strange. I don't think there's, like, any indication. I think he just thought this was a question channel to just, if you felt you had the experience enough to answer, you should answer it. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know what happened with that. I just think it's a weird year for wrestling, and the New Japan just all out of whack. And I do think we will probably end up talking about Two Man Scramble, but I, you know, with everything going on, and just I think overall New Japan was on the downslope anyways, where a lot of the kind of casual fans that were into it for the past 4 years are kind of probably moved on to something else now. So I just don't think it's kind of, I want to say it's going underground, but I don't think it's as talked about in, like, the mainstream wrestling world anymore. So it seems like it's kind of waning. Also, I don't think Jim Cornette would like a Time Bomb Pro show, because Jim Cornette's whole gimmick is to hate everything. So no matter what it is, he's going to hate it.
You know, for me, I don't even think it was after the G1. It was probably after Wrestle Kingdom when Naito finally fucking won it.
Yeah,
like, for me, like, the credits just rolled, and I was like, well, that's it, that's the ending I wanted from New Japan Pro Wrestling. And after that, I didn't really care. I know people pointed to Evil winning the title, but even then I was just kind of over it. But with Kota being the torchbearer now, it does have some interest for me to see how he carries it. So it's been renewed a little bit, but I mean, for me, after that Naito win, like, I don't know.
Yeah,
I'm done with it, I guess, but we'll see.
And that was what Dave Meltzer always warned about, too. He said, like, once he wins it, it's going to be done. And I guess he's kind of right in that aspect. But yeah, as Al said, the Kota Ibushi win is kind of like, it's definitely not out of left field, but as far as the past champions they've had for the past fucking 4 years, it's the most kind of left field choice. I mean, outside of Evil, but that doesn't count. It's kind of the most left field choice they've done. So it's pretty interesting to see how it's going to go. And maybe he'll just lose it. Maybe it'll just be a stupid loss and he'll lose it first defense and we'll be back to not caring about New Japan.
I mean, I guess the ceiling is him just having like these string of matches like Okada.
Yeah.
That's what I'm hoping for, but that's pretty hard to fucking match. But we'll see. I guess I'll tune into it. That was the last email, I think, or unless you wanted to take another Discord question.
No, that was it.
Okay, cool. If you want to participate, email us at virtualpros64@gmail.com. Two-man scramble for 2021, and Dan kind of got me kickstarted here, but we got to clear the air for 2021 here, Mike. Why are you so wrong about Soup?
I just don't think... Soup is... I don't think it's really a meal. I think it's maybe a thing you eat out of necessity sometimes. It's definitely very antiquated. It's like something I think old people eat out of necessity, out of cans. Canned soup, that's a no-go all the time, 100,000% of the time. Canned soup is a no-go. You can't tell me any different. And some, you know, sometimes there are some kind of soups you can get at a restaurant as like an appetizer or a starter. And that's fine. But there's very few soups I would order. And I've tried before. I've tried to be like, I'm going to be a soup guy because it's kind of like diet friendly. And it's just not for me. And even some of like the more common soups, I just don't like miso soup. I don't like it. But the difference is that Al refers to ramen and stuff like that as soup too. And I like stuff like that. Like I like ramen. I like pho. And honestly, I didn't even really like, I liked pho fine, but until I moved here, I wasn't really like looking for it all the time. But just moving here and being closer to more better Vietnamese restaurants or pho restaurants, at least. It's you know, I could see the appeal more, but as far as normal American soups, they're just not for me. Maybe a clam chowder every once in a while. Another soup that I was introduced when I moved here is something called bear cheese soup, which is definitely some fucking super Midwestern shit because it's just melted cheese and bear, I guess. That's not something I think people eat in New York. I've never, I didn't have that until I moved here and I'm like, this is fucking good. I'm sure it's horrible for you. So yeah, stuff like that. Like I said, clam chowder once in a while, nice lobster bisque every once in a while. But otherwise, yeah, I'm not sitting down for soup or stew for that matter. I might even hate stew more than I hate soup. I think stew is fucking bullshit. Chili's good, but stew and soup are kind of bullshit.
Man, I feel like half our audience is just like doing the Arthur fist right now after hearing that 2-minute rant on soups. As a soup enthusiast, I love all soups, man.
Do you like even fucking canned soup?
Oh, man, like a fucking Campbell's clam chowder all fucking day. Oh,
God.
Swanson's chicken noodle. Oh, I get nasty with it, Mike. I don't fucking care.
That's disgusting.
You're disgusting, Mike. What the fuck do you eat when you're sick?
When I'm sick, I more crave like real bready stuff for whatever reason. I want to eat like muffins, which is something I otherwise don't really eat. I want to eat muffins, like thick bread. Like, I don't know, when I'm sick, that's how I feel.
That's fucking crazy, man.
Yeah.
Vert Bags, please write in, with your top soups or if you agree with Mike. I think we had a similar debate about milk.
Yeah,
and that almost started like a civil war.
That's a science fact that,
within the community. Although that
milk is fucking disgusting, you've just been fucking brainwashed into thinking it's good. But that's science fact. Soup is.
I just want to have
soup
strong is bones. That's all. No big deal. I wrote down sobering wrestling fan moment. What did I mean by that? This was like 2 weeks. Okay, I do know where I'm going to go with this. And I apologize for being like a shitty storyteller. So if I don't convey like the sadness that I felt, just chalk it up to that. But a couple weeks ago, I was at Walmart shopping and I remembered that AEW, they dropped their Series 2 figures, and knowing that they go for a pretty good amount on the resale market, I marched over to the toy aisle and I saw one toy there. I was pretty happy. It was MJF, so I didn't think twice about, you know, buying it, because I knew that it was probably at least like $10 more than what I had paid for it. So I sent a picture to my group chat, and a friend of the show, Brady, was like, "Is it the Chase?" And I was like, "That's right. They do have Chase figures." And he was like, "Check the color on the underwear." And I was like, "Fuck, bet." And I look, and I also had a come to Jesus moment at that time where I was like, "What the fuck am I doing with my life, dude? I'm looking at the color of this character's underwear to see whether or not I can triple up or quadruple up instead of make like $10 on top of what I paid." And I was just thinking, Mike, in 2020, did you have any like, you know, moment of clarity moments like that where you were like, "Why do I watch this thing?" Like I did. Seeing whether or not MJF had red or pink panties to fatten my wallet up.
I mean, I've probably had a lot of those moments for the past year, but I chalk it up as there's really nothing else to do, so it's okay. I spend, obviously you're way more into cards than I am, but I spend a lot of time looking at cards on eBay, and I'm just like, what the fuck am I doing? Like, I don't really like these things that much, but I'm just like, I don't know, maybe like it's just something to do. I know a lot of people out there have just given up and just go on their like regular days and do regular shit, like nothing's wrong, but I'm still like in the house 24/7 locked down. So anything I do, I mean, full disclosure, I've picked up playing Pokemon cards on the fucking the computer. I don't care. Like, what else am I gonna do? I don't fucking there's nothing else to do. I've been inside for, I've taught myself video editing, for Christ's sake. That is a big feat for me. So stuff like that. I'm staring at my two AEW dolls that I bought just to make money off of. And I don't know if I'm going to sell them because the prices have since gone down, and I knew that was going to happen. But, you know.
Wait, which two figures?
The Phoenix. I bought Phoenix and Pentagon because I was just like, you know, if they go down by the time I get them, then it's fine. I don't mind having these two dolls. So, but you know, I'm still going to hold on to them. I think they'll probably go back up in a year. So I did buy them just to sell. So, yeah, I mean, you got to do what you got to do right now to keep yourself occupied with shit. Cause, there's not a lot going on.
I can't travel. I can't do a lot of shit, Mike. But yeah, you know what I'm doing? Looking at MJF's panties.
Yeah.
To see whether or not I can make $300.
Yeah. Outside of going
pretty,
to like
pretty bad.
Outside of going to like public events like wrestling and music and stuff like that, which I'm fine with. Like I'm not. You know, every once in a while, I'm like I kind of miss it. But overall, I don't really care. But the two things that I did the most in life for hobbies outside of going to public events is going to restaurants and going to the bar. And I still drink, but it's not the same. And I still eat, and it's not the same. So anything I do with my two main things taken away, I'm not gonna really fucking critique myself over right now. You know, in a year or so, maybe I will, but just not right now.
All right, I feel better about it. Thank you, Mike. I also did get a hot pot delivered the other day, so I'm pretty pumped about that. my last topic. And it's a little bit past its expiration date, but it's Wrestle Kingdom. We usually do an episode right after Wrestle Kingdom, but, you know, full disclosure, I didn't really care that much about Wrestle Kingdom this year. But I did think it was pretty good. I thought that this format of two nights really worked for the most part. I think it actually might be the way I want to watch Wrestle Kingdom from here on out, honestly. I don't want to sit down for 6 hours anymore to watch one event. But I think the match that surprised me the most, and I think other people, was that Jeff Cobb and Takagi match. That was fucking crazy. I thought the two mains were really good, and I thought that Okada really took 2020 as like a load management year off, because he looked fucking incredible. So overall, I'm going to give this event two thumbs up. If you haven't seen it, you should watch it. But what were your overall thoughts on Wrestle Kingdom this year, Mike?
Yeah, I thought it was pretty decent. Watching on Monday and Tuesday is no fun. It's two shitty days. And it's, again, you know, I'm not hanging out with people because I'm not an irresponsible asshole. So I watch it by myself, which is a lot less fun than watching with people. I thought it was the same. I thought it was good, like Al said, except I do prefer to watch it all in one day, I think. I think if you took all the matches Al said, and I thought Kenta versus Kojima was probably a little better than maybe some people expected. It wasn't, you know, must see or anything, but I thought it was pretty good for what it was. If you take all four or five of those matches and just had that and maybe like a couple openers, I think that would have been a better show than what it was. Not saying the other matches were bad, but yeah, I thought Shingo and Jeff Cobb's definitely made himself a star. I thought Osprey and Kota Osprey and Okada was the I think that was my match of the whole Wrestle Kingdom. I thought that match was very good. Yeah, and the two mains were great. I'm never gonna be a huge Switchblade fan. I thought it was pretty good for a Switchblade match, but I don't like. I guess I get what people see in him, but I think he just does the style of wrestling that I don't really care for that much. So it's just kind of like lost on me, and all his matches are fucking 45 minutes long, and it's just I think once he goes to WWE and he just has to do fucking 10 minute matches against, I don't know, fucking Kevin Owens or whatever, it'll probably be he'll probably be amazing at it. But having to do the 50 minute long New Japan style matches with the type of wrestling he does, I don't think is for me. But yeah, overall it was good. And I've also noticed there was definitely not as many people talking about it on the internet. I think for the previous however many years, any kind of big New Japan event, I couldn't even open the internet, no matter it was like my private accounts, the virtual pros account, anything. And it would just be spoiled, like instantly just opening the internet. And not this year. I could scroll like a little, like I could look around on my own private Instagram. No one seemed to care that much. So it was, I think the New Japan kind of love affair is over with a lot of people, which is cool with me. But yeah, it was good. It's you know, kind of bittersweet because you couldn't really do anything. Couldn't really plan around it. I was like watching it during work, so it's not even like I had like a fun time off where I was like eating snacks and drinking beer or anything. So yeah, it was fun, but it definitely seemed a little less like a special event and more just like decent wrestling to watch while working.
Yeah, it was definitely a 180 for me being front row last year, yeah. And then this year sitting crisscross applesauce on my bed watching it on my laptop, so I get it.
Okay, I guess it's time for my two-man scramble. Since that was mentioned, Wrestle Kingdom, I'll just piggyback off that with one of my first ones, which is I was thinking during Wrestle Kingdom, during the Okada match, that Okada like bleaches the shit out of his hair. Like he is he's a Japanese man, so he has naturally very dark hair, and he has like a crazy bleach job for a man with black hair. Like it's pretty bleached. It's and you know, it's kind of always like that, or he has it dyed, and that's not good for your hair to bleach it all the time. And so I'm thinking at some point his hair is gonna be pretty fried, and it's gonna have to make a decision in life probably pretty soon, honestly. So I had a couple questions for Al. If Okada was balding, Al, do you think he would trying to do like the LeBron James hiding it? Because you know, he's just like, you know, he has a certain gimmick where, you know, he's supposed to be like, you know, kind of like a rich, you know, affluent person and like a glamorous person. So you gotta try and think in that mode. Would he hide it like LeBron James? Would he just shave it, or would he kind of try and style it in like a kind of like a Dean Ambrose, John Moxley sort of way, where he works the baldness to his advantage? Like he gives himself like a bald man fade, or a Shinjiro Otani horseshoe. So what out of those three options, what do you think Okada's doing if the bleach is killing his hair and he's losing it?
You think my man would ever come out looking like C.W. Anderson, you're out of your fucking mind. Let's throw that option out. He's for sure going to get like the Elon Musk like plugs or whatever that he gets, like to make sure that no one thinks he's balding, for sure, if that ever happens. I don't think it will. I feel like,
I don't know, man.
Asian hair, as like someone who owns it, is pretty strong. So I don't know.
Bleaching your hair that severely is not good. Okay, follow-up question. Say he doesn't do that. Say he either has to shave. Say he either shaves his head, or he does the C.W. Anderson, or the LeBron, or the Shinjiro Otani, or something like that. Obviously, Okada's a good wrestler. There's some people out there who think he's been carried to all of his good matches for the past 8 or so years, which is seems kind of weird. seems like that's a lot of carrying. But anyways, he's obviously a good wrestler. But a lot of that's probably his appearance. Do you think a lot of people are going to, if, you know, he didn't, like, not one thing changed except his haircut, he comes out with that C.W. Anderson, you think people are going to just be like, yeah, that match was kind of shitty? Or do you think he can hold up the facade of being one of the world's best wrestlers with a horseshoe haircut?
I think people would fucking bail on Okada stock if he came out like C.W. Anderson, for sure. I do think that a lot of people are a fan of his. He's a good-looking dude, man. He looks like a star. And if he does come out, you know, one day with hair like Manu Ginobili or something, who has like a kind of thinning top, yeah, they might take a quarter star off those matches. I do think that. That's not right. But, I don't know, read up about how good-looking people get treated in the workplace. It's just a fucking... it's just a fact of life, man. Yeah. We all got to deal with it. I'm sorry.
So Okada, or somebody knows Okada listening out there, will warn you. I'm going to warn you. Got to stop that bleaching, man. Got to let it... Take a year off. Become Okada dark. Just let the natural hair grow for a little while.
I was just thinking, too. I mean, he's... Say he gets into that like mid-40s, 50s age, still going pretty strong. He goes salt and pepper, forget about it, dude. We're going to get a second renaissance of Okada. I swear to God, if that happens.
Okay.
I can't even talk just thinking about how hot Okada would look with that George Clooney.
My second question, or my second two-man scramble, is that I was watching the whatever the big stardom show is called, like Cinderella Babes or something like that. Cinderella something.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was, you know,
Cinderella Babes. Yeah
Cinderella Babes. It was a big presentation. If you watch Stardom regularly, it's just, you know, kind of no commentary. They do the subtitles and then they just have a match. But this was like a big kind of like Wrestle Kingdom type event. And they had all the bells and whistles. They had commentary. They had fucking graphics. It was crazy. And, so, you know, they want, when the women are wrestling, they show their stats and, you know, their height. I don't think they show, maybe they show the weight, actually. I can't remember. But they show their height, you know, their Twitter, Instagram, whatever. Some shit I can't read. But they're showing heights in centimeters. And Himeka shows up. And I'm like, oh, I got to see what they're saying her height is to see if, like, like, I know from MMA, from UFC, that Japanese have kind of a different approach to stuff like that. They're more honest when it comes to stuff. Like, they're honest about their weight in mixed martial arts, and I think they're more honest about their height than they are, and then people are in America. So, you know, they show her whatever it is in centimeters, and I convert it. I think I converted it wrong, and I think I came up with 5'6", but in real life, I think she's 5'7". At first, when I was like, when I didn't realize I converted it wrong, I was like, there's no way she's 5'6". That's crazy. And then I was thinking, the question is that, you know, here, like I said, in America, even, I mean, not even just wrestling, like all sports, like fucking they do this shit in basketball too, where they bump people up a few inches. It's not just wrestling. Do you think in Japan, because it's different, and that there's, people in Japan are on average shorter than people in America, and that since it's women, do you think that they might kayfabe the height in the other way, where they're just like, she's tall, but trust me, you could still overtake her if you had to. So do you think they're shaving a few inches off Himeka? Maybe she's really 5'9", and they're like, we got to say she's like 5'6.5", or these guys might be scared of her.
I don't know, dude. That's so tough. And I know we talked about it like in the past two-man scramble about how like how is this woman 5'7"? Because it looks like everyone that yeah, she dude. Wrestles yeah, would
if,
be
if,
like
if she's 5'7", then
six.
If she's 5'7", there's no one in Stardom over 5 feet tall. Then, like, it doesn't add up.
I'm not gonna shut down your conspiracy theory, Mike, but I don't know, dude. That's tough. I did read 5'7" as a sort of lightweight height truther for Himeka Arita as well.
Yeah,
and I'm gonna go with that. I'll say 5'7" is probably the shoot height, but I wouldn't be surprised if I know Kevin Garnett never wanted to be labeled as a 7-footer because he thought that meant that like he was like an oaf. but I think he actually was 7 feet at one point in his life, apparently. So maybe it's like a Kevin Garnett thing where she's like, listen, I know I'm 5'10", but yeah. Don't put that out there.
Yeah, I don't know. It might be. Guys, people out there, you know, there's the Bahus out there. There's other people that listen to the show that live in Japan. Let us know. Are they height truth in the other way in Japan? So making people shorter, making women shorter? Last two-man scramble. Back to AEW and the Dolls. I was watching AEW as I do every week, and it's something I always harp on. I always talk about. It's that they make all their, well, not everybody, but you know, a lot of people, a lot of factions, a lot of wrestlers. They have an old wrestler manager, and I know that probably works to some extent with actual like fans that have been watching wrestling for a while. But AEW heads of AEW, for you're out there listening. This does not work with casual fans. My girlfriend fucking hates it. Like, she hates seeing these old people. She's old, like, we're old. We're old people. But she doesn't want to see old people on TV. And she's just like, anytime they card out a new old man, she's just like, Jesus Christ. Like, what's this guy? And I have to explain to her, he's some fucking popular wrestler from 300 years ago. And she's just like, I don't fucking care. Why do they have to show him? And I gotta explain. But so it doesn't work. But I was thinking, I think this is like an opportunity in a weird way where I don't know if it'll ever be popular, but I think they should really push the limit. These dolls, the AEW dolls, are popular. They sell out immediately. You can only get them from Walmart or Ringside Collectibles. And as soon as they get put up for order, they're gone. And then they're crazy on eBay. I don't know if they could hold this popularity, but I'm thinking they should make because they do like five or six at a time. They should do a series of the AEW elders. Of all of the old man and the one old woman wrestlers that are now managers. And I think they should do this because I was thinking about it. And I don't think, there's people who know these figures way better than I do. So I'm sure there's people that have examples. But I don't think there's many examples out there of a person like a Jake the Snake or a Taz that had like a wrestler, a doll of them when they were in their prime. That then, like 30 years later, is an updated where they're kind of out of shape and shitty looking and fucking their skin's loose. Like, I don't think they make dolls like that. Like, I'm not positive, but I don't think that exists. I don't think that form of doll exists. I think when they do make, like when Ric Flair was probably on like his last run and his tits were all saggy and he was out of shape and he looked like fucking disgusting old man. I'm sure when they made his dolls, he still looked great. For example, the one WWE doll I own is that fucking Bobby Heenan doll. And if you take off his suit, he's jacked under it. He has like fucking muscles. It's not like what Bobby Heenan's body would look like. So I think there's a market for this kind of like a shitty Tully Blanchard doll and a shitty Jake the Snake. And let's be honest, only adults buy these anyway, so it doesn't matter. It's not like a kid's going to be like, I don't want that fat old man. I don't need to play. I don't need Sting with his fucking thin hair, his thin, like, fucking gross cotton candy string hair that looks all dusty. Like, but it would be, I think it would be a cool doll. Second reason, back to kids, why I think it would be cool for kids is that I remember when I was a kid and, like, I would, like, maybe a relative that I didn't really see too often, or, you know, just some kind of, like, situation like that, maybe a family member's friend or something, somebody that has to get you a gift but doesn't want to really invest too much time in it. They would get you, like, a toy, and it would kind of suck, but you were a kid, so you're just like, oh, this is a toy, but it does suck, but it is a toy. Like, I remember there's multiple years in a row that somebody would buy me, like, not even GoBots, but, like, rip-off GoBots, and I'd just be like, I don't even like fucking GoBots, but it's a toy, I guess this is cool. I don't know what to do with it. And I was thinking, I'm that relative now. I have a fucking nephew. I never see him. I have to ask my fucking sister like what he's into. He's not into wrestling, but I'm thinking they make a Tully Blanchard doll. I could just send it to him, just be like, here, dude. And he'll just be like, what the fuck? Why did my uncle that I never see send me this old man doll? What does this mean? And that would be like the ultimate troll that I could do. So I think these dolls would serve multi-purposes. I'm like, honest to goodness, people out there that actually collect these things and not just buy them to sell for money. Don't you think this would be a cool idea? Don't you want an old, broken down piece of meat Jake Roberts? You don't need the in-shape Jake Roberts. Don't you want like a fucking regular Vicky Guerrero or who? I mean, Taz kind of looks the same. He looks more like a guy who watches Little League Baseball and doesn't have children. But it would still be cool to have like that kind of representation of Taz. So I don't know. Just spitballing. I think it's a good idea.
I just imagine like this, the packaging like Werther's colored, maybe coming in like this really fake like leather looking case, perhaps.
Yeah.
I'm behind this. I want this. As
yeah, well. That's another good example because I think it was Don in our Discord posted a picture of an Arn Anderson doll, and it hit like even peak Arn Anderson. This doll had way more hair than Arn Anderson has ever had. It's enough is enough. I am sick of covering up people's imperfections to meet society standards. I want old man action figures. I want them to be realistic. I don't want this fucking society's idea of a perfect body on a fucking 70-year-old man. I want a 70-year-old man doll.
Book it. Ringside Collectibles, if you're listening. Hire my man Mike. He has ideas, as you see here. Was that your last one?
Yeah, that's it.
Today's topic, the 2020 Virtual Pros Year-End Awards. We look at the weirdest year of wrestling ever and hand out trophies to the heroes that deserve it. Please stay tuned. Virtual Pros episode 123, kid. And today's topic is our year-end awards. You know what this is. And we made some, you know, awards that are exclusive to the Virtual Pros brand. If you're a first-time listener, I think you'll follow along. But there's some staples that I'm excited to, you know, give out awards for. So I guess we'll start with the Bobby Heenan Memorial Award. This is for the best non-wrestling character in wrestling. And for me, this guy, he just continually crafts his roster to be the best it could be. And he did it again in 2020 with very key athletic signings like Mina Shirakiwa, Unagi Sayaka. He can't stop and he won't stop. And I'm going to put a bold bet out there. I don't have any insight on this at all, but he's going to invade Tokyo Joshi Pro. And he's taking some fucking talent with him. And that is Rossi Ogawa. So congratulations, Rossi. You are my favorite booker. You're my favorite owner. You are the George Steinbrenner of this wrestling shit. And you deserve our love from Virtual Pros.
I'm very excited for Al to get canceled by the internet because I think Rossi is like some kind of sleazebag that all the internet people hate. So
he's a sleazy wrestling promoter. Whoa.
Yeah, I know. It's crazy. But for some reason, it's horrible when it's with all women, but yeah, I await Al getting canceled. I can't wait for it. I also should note, I just saw the time. This is going to be a long episode, guys, but it's okay. We took a month off, so it's fine.
People love it.
Yeah. Mine is a little cheating. It's slightly cheating because it's an actual wrestler, but it's in a non-wrestling role, but I couldn't not give him his props. Wrestling in America, especially independent wrestling, has been pretty dark. It's all been very shitty. It's been trying to just grab money and make excuses as to why they need this money, even though it's kind of on the independent level and it should be a hobby. But anyways, there was one bright beacon of hope in the summer, and it was on IWTV, and it was a wrestler who changed, I guess, you know, changed the job a little. And he has a new show on IWTV called Spider Nate Webb Cooking in the Kitchen. And this is just Spider Nate Webb, the wrestler, just cooking in the kitchen. That's all he does. He's like a regular guy, just like you and me. And he's making regular guy food. And he's teaching people who probably don't know how to cook food how to make pretty simple, decent stuff. He's telling like weird wrestling stories. He's, you know, he's a pretty interesting guy. It's not like jaded or vindictive like a lot of wrestling things are when wrestling people talk. It's fun. It's chill. And they did like 5 or 6 episodes and then it just stopped. And then they promised a second season. And I'm still waiting. But this is, you know, this show got me through independent wrestling for a good month and a half because it was a great show. I asked them on Twitter, both Spider-Nate Webb and IWTV, when season 2 was happening. No answer, which is not a good sign because these people are not famous enough to big time me. So that's a bad sign. Maybe something happened. Maybe they lost all the footage. Maybe they had a falling out. But you know, I think he really deserved it for me this year to highlight him and his show. So if you haven't checked it out and you have IWTV, I don't think it's called Spider Nate Webb Cooking in the Kitchen. I think it has a different name, but that's my name for it. I'm sure if you search that string of words, you'll find it on there. But it really entertained me. And he made some, you know, some stuff I would even consider gross. Like, I think he was using like canned shrimp and stuff, and not for me, but it works. The next award is the Virgil Autograph Line Award. This is basically for the fucking dumbest wrestler, the saddest wrestler of 2020. A lot of competition this year. Both, or all, not even just both, a few. Ryback, Austin Aries, TJP, all these guys put in banner years of just sadness of being the worst. Brian Pillman Jr. is in there. A lot of Just Asking Questions guys. Low-key was another guy, Mass Denier. But the one guy who went above and beyond was from WWE, Jackson Ryker. Unrepentant racist, just a complete piece of shit. I don't know how you don't get fired when you're just like being like real weird about protests for George Floyd and, you know, just having that kind of attitude in public. And then some sketchy Instagram post came out, and all WWE did was take him off TV for a few months. And now he's just, I think he's somebody's butler or something. I think he's Elias's butler on television now, which I guess is his punishment, but his punishment should just be being unemployed. But even though I think Ryback had a banner year, and obviously so did Austin Aries and TJP, I really couldn't not give this guy his due because I'm hoping he won't have a job by 2021. So, and we can go back to Ryback and him fucking begging Twitter every other week to give him a check mark like a fucking bitch. So Ryback will have more opportunities to, I think, three-peat the Virgil Autograph Line Award. But for this year, I'm giving it to Jackson Ryker.
You just needed to have some cilantro in your life, Mike. You sound pretty mad. You might need to just mix in some cilantro and just get that adjusted yourself. But yeah, dude, a lot of people put in their fucking scoring title seasons in 2020 for fucking sure. A lot of people definitely showed their ass, and it's definitely a tough field to navigate. But I had to give it to one of the most prominent pieces of trash of last year. And sadly, that's Chris Jericho, alongside giving terrible people a platform to talk. I can't even like Judas anymore, man. And that fucking sucks, personally. And, you know, he's pretty washed. It's just time to hit that trail, I think.
Yeah.
Like 1,004 moves was like 23 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I thought the first two books were like pretty like fun reads, but I can let it go just fine. It's over, so... Also, Chris Jericho, you could enjoy this award.
Also, they had that whole thing where they're like, "Oh man, we're after the NBA. We're gonna put Jericho on," and it was just a bunch of teens just fucking ripping Jericho apart. And that should be—I mean, between that, the Trump shit, just being like a fucking honest huge piece of shit, they should just let him go. He's not really adding any ratings. So, I agree with Al.
Next up is the Sabu Early Funeral Award. This goes to wrestling's biggest daredevil. And this year for me, it's Shotzi Blackheart, friend of the show Brady. He described Shotzi's wrestling style pretty well, and I'm paraphrasing. It's someone that pretty much wrestles outside of their skill level, and that sounds really bad. But with Shotzi, like, she's just going for it every episode on Wednesday, and it's kind of horrifying to watch. Like, just watch her do any outside dive, and she's pretty much folding herself up like a beach chair. And every time I see her, she's just really, really tempting fate. And so 2020 especially was a pretty wild year for her, so I thought I'd give her kudos here. So congratulations, Shotzi.
Yeah, I think that's a good choice, because I was watching a match today with Taka Michinoku in it, and he did like his Asaya moonsault in it, and I was just like, man, it's so crazy that people just learn how to do that, and like so effortlessly, basically, just for fat people on the internet to shit on them. But like, it's pretty crazy, like just shit like that. Like Pac last night did his red arrow move, and it's just like, that is some shit to learn how to do and like land on the person. And I've seen Shotzi Blackheart doing that dive outside for a couple years now. I don't think she's never gonna learn, and I don't think she plans on learning how to do it safely. And that is pretty amazing. She has that Sabu style of just I know, like, this is how I learned how to do it, and I'm not gonna change it. I mean, she lives in a fucking school of wrestling. They could probably teach her how to not do it dangerously, but she just refuses to learn. So yeah, it's a good pick. Maybe not something you would immediately think of, but I think she's definitely earned it. Mine is a little more literal. It is all the wrestlers that are catching and spreading COVID-19 in 2020.
Oh, boy. Come on, Mike.
This is a literal early funeral, because I know everybody thinks it's fine to catch it and not show symptoms, but I think there's some college football team that had a bunch of COVID-positive tests, and they did tests on all of the football players' hearts, and like 30% of them just had like inflated hearts after being asymptomatic. So keep being antagonistic about COVID on the internet, and we'll see where you are in a few years. So all you guys who are just getting COVID and spreading it, good job. Early funeral for you. You're just like my hero Sabu. Next award is a quick one. White Guy in Panties Award, best technical wrestler. Fifth time in a row for me. Sixth time even, maybe. ZSJ, I have nowhere else to go. I didn't watch a ton of wrestling this year, and what I did watch, not really a big technical wrestling guy. I've never been, and I've still never seen anybody who makes me give a shit about it in modern times outside of ZSJ. So he's an easy win for me once again.
I refuse, Mike. I refuse to give in. My award winner this year for the White Guy in Panties Award is Timothy Thatcher.
Ah, that's a good one.
He was pretty fucking sweet in 2020. Yeah. He had that fight pit with Matt Riddle. Love that. He had some pretty good matches with Finn Balor and Oney Lorcan. And he does that style in a real... I wouldn't say like it's completely engaging, because I just do think at the end of the day, like, they're not really trying to break each other's arms, man. Like, I'll just watch UFC for that. But if I had to watch that kind of style, I guess it'd be him.
Yeah, I've kind of fell out in NXT, but I have been meaning to check his shit out. So maybe I will just check his shit out. So maybe ZSG has some competition in 2021.
Next award is the Mr. Pogo Memorial Award. I guess this is for the best brawler. I suppose that's how I interpret it. It's Jon Moxley. He had some pretty good matches last year with Minoru Suzuki. Eddie Kingston was fucking sweet. That barbed wire thing on the mouth, woof. And Kenny Omega was also a pretty good match too, even though I wouldn't really classify that as a brawl, but it was still pretty good. He was really well-rounded, so kudos to Jon Moxley.
This was the one award I was thinking about skipping, just because I've seen a decent amount of brawlers this year, but nothing where I just felt good enough about giving them an award. Past winners, Nick Gage for me. He was injured in the summer, so he didn't really wrestle too much. Mance Warner, I saw a few matches of his, but not too much. Moxley's out there, but I'm not really sold on his brawling style. It's okay, but I don't think it's the greatest. So I went with a real weird one. This is kind of a Pain Pig's favorite. And so I just decided to give it to a personal choice, and that is a man named Crazy Frank. He's a Mexican wrestler, not a very popular one. He doesn't even do Zona 23. I don't know why. I imagine it's because he's kind of a Zona 23 type, but he doesn't do it. And I assume it's because he lives in a part of Mexico and he doesn't have a car or doesn't drive or something, and he can't get there. Because he seems like he would be right up their alley, but he was kind of a big discovery this year for me and the other people who watch Pain Pigs. He's a pretty good brawler. I don't really know why he's not more prominent in this kind of scummy Mexican wrestling. Like I said, maybe it's just where he lives or something. But if you see Crazy Frank listed in those YouTube listings, or you know, you watch Pain Pigs or just download it, check him out, because he's had some pretty good brawls. Next award is we're foregoing the Stump Meltzer award, because it was funny like the first year, and I think every other year we've done it, that's just been a diminishing return, so we're getting rid of it. So next award is PayPal presents the best merch of 2020, and I usually try and pick at least one like corporate type of merch, but I didn't do that this year. This is actually a, I guess you would say, fan made merch. And it's Mecha Shote's Toshiaki Kawada soccer jersey that they or he or she or I guess it's a he because it's one guy, a he, made. I think it was, you know, it was summer, fall he made it. Usually when somebody that's not like a big company makes a piece of merch that's out of, you know, a little off the beaten path, I don't trust it because I have a feeling it's going to be shitty. But this was made by like a real soccer jersey maker. This wasn't just like some fucking t-shirt that they all overprinted and made look like a soccer jersey. This is like an actual, as the British would or the English would call them, a football kit. This is an actual like football kit maker from England that made this. It looks amazing. I have been like I think the one regret of all virtual pros is we never made a Kawada shirt, and I was like the one thing I wanted to do, and I just never had any good idea for it. And overall, I just don't think there's ever been a lot of Kawada merch ever where I was just like, I need that. And sad because he's one of my favorite wrestlers, but this is the first thing where I was like, man, this is fucking cool as hell. It was a good price. It wasn't like soccer jerseys are fucking expensive no matter how you get them. This was a decent price. It was coming from England, and it still got here super quick. Shipping was good. I don't know if he has any left, but I thought it was just an amazing, amazing shirt, and I'm glad I got it. But check him out, Mecha Shote. I'm sure it's just MechaShote.com, but that's also his Twitter. So check it out. Like I said, I don't know if he has any left because it's been a few months, but it's a great piece of merch.
It is a good looking piece of merch, but I want to sidebar for a minute, Mike, if you don't mind. I recently got into soccer cards heavy, super heavy. And I am committed to one Ansu Fati because his success is my success. So if you had to equate, like, I guess my team now is just Barca. What would you equate that to, like, rooting for a U.S. team? Like, is that like being a Yankees fan, a Lakers fan, a Cowboys fan? Where would you put that?
First off, you sound like a Yankees fan because it's pronounced Barca. But
I've heard it so many different ways, man. But, like, there's so... the entry is just too high for soccer, dude. But
okay. I don't really follow the Spanish league. So I don't think Barcelona's really like there. I don't even know if they ever really hit that kind of Yankees level of. I guess maybe at one point they were the Yankees of the Spanish league, but I mean, I think every soccer league has those handful of teams that are kind of just dump money as much as they can in like the Yankees type of way. But I would put them, you know, more of like a dynasty that does it, like maybe a Celtics or something like that. So I don't think it's as obnoxious, but I think if you are an American fan of any of these types of foreign leagues, you're obviously going to gravitate towards a handful of teams. Cause you're not gonna follow Elche and this Spanish league, because I don't think they have any fucking players. So obviously you're gonna follow like the teams that have the handful of good players. So it's UEFA too. Yeah, but yeah, I don't think that Yankees rule applies when it comes to international soccer.
I can get down with the Celtics. That's fine. Celtics are cool. I went corporate because I'm an asshole.
My best merch of 2020 was WWE Tops finest set. This year, it was a chance to get rookie cards of Rhea Ripley and Shotzi Blackheart. And that's like getting Zion and Ja in basketball. So for those that are thinking about getting into cards, specifically wrestling, I think these cards, for the value, for how they look, I think this is the best set that WWE did last year. On the flip side, the direct-to-trash, worst merch of 2020, there was one piece of merch that stood out, and it was the replica Super J Cup jacket. I don't know if you've seen this, Mike.
Yeah, I've seen it. Yeah.
But it looks like you are, if you were to put it on, like you're like a baked potato or something. This jacket looks horrific. I don't think there's anything that's lost its luster more than the Super J Cup event. It's, I don't even think people like 95, you know, like for the most part, except for the Ray versus Psychosis match. And I know for sure people thought the third one sucked in 2000. So it's been 26 years. We can just let Super J Cup go, I think. And this jacket really didn't need to be made, especially when El Fantasmo has won it the past 2 years. I just don't see the demand for it. And plus, like, it doesn't look functional at all. It's just a mess. I hated this.
Yeah, man. New Japan, be fair. Sell the Super J Cup gimmick to another wrestling promotion, and I'll do something with it. Let all the smaller promotions back into it. This fucking using a bunch of American indie wrestlers or whatever is just bad. I don't know what they were going for that jacket. I'm sure there was some idea behind it that they're missing. It kind of looked to me like if you won like a video game championship in like 1989, that would be like the jacket you won for winning the championship. That's I don't think I hate it as much as Al did. I wouldn't say it's the worst merch, but it's definitely kind of a shit thing. My answer is, and I do want to give some credit where credit's due. This is an award where it's usually very easy to shit on WWE. But for the first time in a very long time, I'm not going to say WWE had amazing merch this year, but it's the first time where I think I went like a solid, you know, 4 or 5 months without seeing a WWE shirt that made me like roll my eyes and groan. Like they're really, I don't know if the pandemic had them fire people and hire better designers. I don't know if people have less to do, so they're not as busy and they could concentrate on stuff, but they've had, you know, pretty passable designs all year. So it's good to see WWE like a little out of the dumpster. My answer is, it's technically wrestling. It's from Pro Wrestling Tees, of course. I'm never going to forget the owner had a little spicy tweets around the George Floyd protest, and I'm never going to forget that. So I'm always going to get a chance to fucking shit on these dudes. But they made like a, what some people call a battle vest for like patches and stuff, which is like a denim vest that, you know, it started off as like a metal thing where like dudes would put like their metal patches on it, and it's somehow migrated into wrestling, and I don't fucking know how. I hate the term battle vest. I think it's become like this weird thing for like pose dog metal people, and now that it's like a wrestling thing, and they made one and it had like, you know, holes in it already and patches on it already, and it's just had like strong like fucking JCPenney vibes or something where you're just like, oh man, mom, I don't want that. That's not what I wanted. I was like, it looks like something I wanted, but it's not what I wanted. Pro Wrestling Tees is a notoriously overpriced company, and this thing was like $20. So I don't even know what it was made out of. It was probably made out of some like fucking plastic shavings or something, because I don't know how they have anything that cheap that they charge fucking $25 for their shitty t-shirts, no less their good t-shirts. So I don't know how they're getting away with charging $25 for a denim vest. So there's definitely some shit stuff. It's a trend. I'm glad, you know, we couldn't be in public, because I don't want to see wrestling battle vests. It's not a thing I want to see. So even though this technically wasn't like the worst design thing, it's still something that symbolizes something I really hate. So that is my answer. Next award is the Vader Social Media Strategist Award. I should explain, because I've had to mention this to a couple people this year. The Vader Social Media Strategist was named because it was when Vader was alive, and he accidentally, or actually purposely, somewhere in the middle, sent a picture of his dick to Twitter. He tweeted a picture of his dick out, and That's why it's like a sarcastic name. But anyway, this is for the best social media presence. I usually stick to Twitter, and I got to go with Effie this year. This guy, like I mentioned earlier in the show, there's a lot of meme wrestlers rising up where it's just kind of like, I don't know, it's kind of like, fuck, what was that thing that always stuck out of the ceiling? Fuck, it was way back in the day. Anyways, begin with a K, but whatever it was. It's, you know, but it's, this is just like, you know, fucking liking, God, why are no big memes, coming to mind? It's kind of like vote for Pedro. Like there's a lot of vote for Pedro wrestlers now where it's just like people like it. And there's probably people who own that vote for Pedro shirt that didn't even see Napoleon Dynamite. They just saw the shirt and they're like, man, that's a cool shirt. And I think they're getting like that with wrestling where there's wrestlers people like that, they've probably never seen wrestle, and that's crazy. But it's good for them. It's good for the wrestlers. It's just a crazy thing to think about. But I think Effie is, he has that appeal where he's like appealing to many, many different people that aren't even probably wrestling fans necessarily, like maybe casual wrestling fans, but he isn't a meme either. Like he's an actual dude. And I think that's pretty awesome that he's doing that. And he's, you know, he's very fiercely independent. I don't think he wants to sign to WWE or anything like that. So I hope nothing but for the best of him, and I think he's had the best social media this year.
Yeah, for me, my favorite social media presence of 2020 was Asuka for Kana-chan TV. There were some banger episodes. Most notably, she goes to a hair salon owned by an old friend in Osaka, and that's been one of my favorite plot twists in 2020 because now she's adding characters to Kana. And he's a hunk, so there's a definite will they or won't they component now to Kana-chan TV that has me hooked. On top of that, she's just buying a lot of wild shit like camera equipment, and anytime anyone does that, you know that they're getting the bag, because camera lenses to me have always been like 40 grand, and she's just buying a couple of them. And I think she bought like a Montclair jacket the other day. It's pretty fucking sweet, dude. She's living a good life, and she deserves it. The next award is the 2020 Rusev Horns. This is the best theme of 2020, and this is kind of cheating because I think this technically came out in December of 2019, but I'm going to allow it because this is my radio show, Virtual Pros, and that's the Kabuki Warriors. It was just such a good move from them having that theme where they just went between each other's themes. Mm-hmm. Between Kairi Sane and Asuka, which sounded broke as fuck, and they went with this new theme, and it was pretty sweet. So that's going to be my vote.
Yeah, mine was, I was worried because I was like, there was nothing I really heard this year that was new. And then at the 11th hour, I started watching Stardom again somewhat regularly. And I guess Oedo Tai got a new theme, and it's the only thing I could describe it as is, I guess, moody dubstep. It's just very, you know, I don't know, like depressing dubstep music. And it's pretty cool. I like it a lot. I think it's their whole group's theme, because usually one of the bigger members come out, they have their own themes. But I think it's like them as a group. It definitely does not hold a candle to old Oedo Tai themes, but it's as far as current Stardom themes go, it's probably the best one, and I like how menacing dubstep it sounds, like the fucking Serbian film dubstep. So that gets my award, and I do believe that might have actually technically came out in 2022. So great. Next one is the kind of the wrestler to watch that we called it wrestler to watch in 2021. I have, if you are a new listener, I have famously cursed every single wrestler I have ever voted for in this this thing. So
Apollo Crews was one. Who else did you pick? Stratlander was your pick.
Who's been injured all this year? I picked Matt Riddle. It didn't bite him in the ass the year I picked him, but it bit him in the ass this year. There's been a few more that have just kind of, it's been a bit bad for me. So I hope I don't curse this person. I have a backup too, because I have the genuine person to win it, and then another one that's kind of like, you know, it's like, who am I telling? Like, everybody knows it. It's common sense. But my actual one to watch is, speaking of Stardom, it's Saya Iida. This is another one that, like, last time I left off in Stardom, before I started watching it again, Saida was, like, one of the new people they brought in that looked like she was 12 years old, and I automatically just blacked them out, like, because those wrestlers in Stardom are the ones that remind me that this is a very, very dirty, bad hobby, so I just pretend they don't exist. And I did not know she's older. She's not an actual teen. She's, like, 23. She just looks like a teen. But she looked kind of like plain, like every person who comes to Stardom kind of just looks like a plain person. And then after a few months, they, you know, they do their magic and then they're superstars. And Saida had that kind of plain look, but she's fucking jacked. She's tiny. But she looks like a real wrestler now. And she's like, for a person who's only been wrestling for a year, I think she's going to be one of the all time greats. Maybe, not like translating to America, but I think as far as Japanese women's wrestling, I think she might be one of the all-time greats. My other one is the one where you got to be a dummy not to see this, but it's Ricky Starks from AEW. I think everybody's just praising how good this dude is. But I just want to, I'm just going to call it that, you know, like last year, I think a lot of people thought Darby Allin and Orange Cassidy started punching above their weight where no one could have predicted how popular they're going to get. And I think Ricky Starks is the next up where he's going to be that level by this time next year.
I didn't want to do a layup pick either because I had him and Shotzi Blackheart as just like such layup picks in 2021. Yeah. And I do have some honorable mentions to Ram Kaicho and Maya Yukihi. I know Maya's been around for a minute, but the latest BBM True Heart set had like 9,000 cards of her. So like reading the tea leaves, like that must mean something. So I think she's for 2021. But knowing Mike's curse, his Madden curse on predicting wrestlers, I decided to kind of undo it. And I think this is the first because my 2021... we called it wrestler, is also Saida. I think she checks like a lot of things off, man. Like she has a very quirky look. I think she actually might be 4'6", like we were talking about earlier with High Truth and Stardom. She looks like she could snap anyone in half because she is fucking jacked and she does everything super well. I watched a promo of hers and it read pretty well, and she can fucking wrestle, and the ceiling's pretty high for someone that young, so look out, Saida. You have the cosign from two of the world champion sound, and I'm excited to see what happens. The next award, we're wrapping up here, is the best live match, and I think only one person went to watch wrestling live in 2020, and that was me. And the best match I saw last year was Naito versus Okada at Wrestle Kingdom. That match was fucking incredible for the reasons I mentioned earlier. We finally got to see a conclusion to the Naito saga, and it was so fucking sweet to see live. I think people were crying around me. I was giving people high fives, probably because I was drunk, but it was really a sweet match to watch in person, so that's my pick.
I went to a handful of wrestling. And luckily, one of the wrestlings I did go to has like an all-time banger on it, and it was, I don't remember the name of the pay-per-view, but it was the last AEW pay-per-view before the world shut down. And then
That's right. Yeah, you go to that.
That had the Hangman Page, Kenny Omega versus Young Bucks match on it, and this is by default. This is one of the best matches I've ever seen live. I think if I got to see wrestling all year like it was normal, I'd probably have like some kind of deep cut that was like a little more, I don't know, just, you know, like had a little more seasoning on it. That just wasn't your standard amazing match. But I'm so glad I was here to see this. So that this was an easy choice for me, given I had like four shows to pick from. Next is the best mixtape match, an award I always look forward to because I get to look back on what we watched. We had a lot less episodes this year than normal, given circumstances. But this match is, I think this goes on my all-time list. It's one of the all-time best matches, and it's Prince Devitt and Taguchi versus Carl Machine Gun Anderson and Giant Bernard. Whoever guessed Lord Tensai would be in a get such a big accolade in his life, but this is from the 2009 G1 Tag League Finals. This is a match that, you know, people will always say this is one of the better tag team matches. I always heard that. But then I look at the people in it, and I'm like, it's probably just fine. But this match is, like, super fucking good. And one of the the all-time best tag team matches I've ever seen. Honorable mention goes to that Sabu match we watched last week, or last episode, because that was a surprising banger, too. But I think, you know, this G1 Tag League match is an all-time great.
Funny you should mention it, because my best mixtape match of 2020 was my pick of Sabu and Giant Kamala versus Yoshinari Ogawa and Manu Kamas, man. This came out of left field for me, for sure. And, you know, a lot of people talk shit about Sabu, but, man, he fucking showed out in this match pretty hard. And so it's that, and it's that All Japan style of tag team wrestling. It was up there for me, so I gave it that award. Best tag team is pretty quick for me. It's a Himeka Arita and a Natsu Poi. I really haven't seen any of their matches, but I like the whole thing that they do about hugging. That's pretty cool. And the piggyback thing.
AEW definitely has a lot of tag teams, and they have a lot of tag team matches. But I don't know. I always think about it, because I've been on record on the show being like, I'm not really a tag team guy. And I do think I like more of tag teams that are just like two people that are teaming up because they have to. I like that style of tag team. I don't really like, hey, we're a tag team and that's all we do.
You don't like when people match. You're on record of saying
that. Yeah. And it's just, I don't know. I just have no connection to tag teams like that. So mine is super left field. It's two other heroes of Pain Pigs and kind of the whack wrestling we've had this year. It's two guys no one really knows. It's Aborto and Chinek from DTU, Mexican Wrestling Promotion. You might not know them by name, but these guys participated in the water park death match that happened. You might have caught wind of that. And they also competed in the farm death match. And lesser known, the Cantina Deathmatch, which was inside of a bar. But those first two, the water park and the barn deathmatch, were some of my favorite matches of the year, and definitely honest to God match of the year contenders. And these guys are, I don't know how often they tag team together, but they are kind of always paired together. So they're basically in two match of the year contenders for me. So it was an easy pick, even though they're definitely very far from being household names. But Bordo and Chinek. MVP, basically our wrestler of the year. Mine was to, I think this is the second time I've given to him. It's Kenny Omega. I think this guy, a lot of people hate on him now, because I've predicted this. I predicted this on the show many years ago that people would start to hate him. That's just how it works. But this guy really proved it. I think people were saying he somehow made a mistake by being goofy Kenny Omega, but he's become dickhead Kenny Omega, and he's amazing at it. He had fucking matches in AAA that were amazing. He's really shown that he's not just fucking bullshit, and New Japan wasn't a fluke. He really went out there and had a year for himself despite all of the shitty things that have been going on. So this was an easy one for me.
I had an easy one too. It was a layup, and I'm gonna go with it because the stats show it. And it was Io Shirai. It's like that one year when Westbrook, I think, had the triple-double average. They were just like, I guess we have to give it to him. Because Io Shirai did not lose one match, I think, in 2020. On top of that, she took that dark character to a new level, and people love it. And I think every single match she had was kind of must-watch. Her and Sasha Banks was super good. Ripley was fucking crazy. Everything she's been in is pretty magic. She did the Sasuke spot with the garbage can over the head, forget about it. She was the best. Match of the year. Shout out to a friend of the show, Emily Pratt. She agrees with me. And that's it. Naito versus Okada, Wrestle Kingdom. Easy. Just watch it.
I had, like I said, a couple runner-ups. That pool death match. something people have already forgotten that was amazing for like a week and everybody forgot, but I still think it was amazing, was the cinematic match of John Cena and The Fiend at WrestleMania. John Cena is not seen again. That was real outside of the box shit that WWE did and never revisited it, just left it alone. And it's probably for the better. Kenny Omega and Laredo Kid at Triple Mania, Pagano and Chessman at Triple Mania. But I'm going to have to go with what was my also live match of the year. Again, Kenny Omega and Hangman Page versus Young Bucks from February. This was, I think I said it when we talked about it when it happened, but this was something that I was kind of being selfish about when It was starting where I was just like, man, I don't know if I'm ever going to see Kenny Omega again. I hate that I have to see him in like just like a tag team with the Young Bucks, who I don't even really like. But this match was just fucking amazing from start to finish. And like I said, again, with the live match thing, maybe if it was a different year, I'd go with something with a little seasoning. But again, I think Dave Meltzer gave this 6 stars. So I'm in good company with saying this is my match of the year. And I'm glad if this is really my one Kenny Omega match that I see in my lifetime live, I'm glad it was this one.
You've seen some bangers live, Mike. You saw Sasha Bailey won. You saw Gargano Andrade. Man, you're kind of a good luck charm, I feel like. You saw that Elgin versus ZSJ match together. Remember that?
Yeah.
Anyway, that was our award show. Next up, last up, is the mixtape with Kenno, some Stardom. Very heavy Stardom episode for 2021. That's fine. Alexander Otsuka and Ricky Starks. Please stay tuned.
And I heard him say, nothing's ever promised tomorrow today. From the shine like Tim is a hard away. So this is in the name of love, like Robert say. Before you ask me to go get a job today, can I at least get a raise on a minimum wage? And I know the government administer aid, so I guess we just pray like the ministers say. I'm throwing some hot cars. Things we seen on the screen, it's not hard. But these niggas from the hood, so these strings not far. Where I'm from, the dope boys is the rock stars. They can't cop cars without seeing cop cars. I guess they want us all behind bars. I know it.
Okay, we are back here on a Virtual Pros episode 123. This is our final segment, the world famous mixtape segment. Each week, each episode, we pick a couple matches from YouTube each, and we talk about them. We put them on our playlist at Virtual Pros Mixtape. You can follow along at home and watch them. My first match of the night is I went with a little theme here and chose both of my picks for the ones to watch in 2021, because I figure that's a fitting theme for the first episode of the year. So my first one, I guess I'll go with Micah versus Saya Iida. This was from Stardom. I think it happened in December. It might happen November, December. This, I'm going to be right out with it. This isn't like an amazing match, but since it's Stardom, they don't have tons of shit on YouTube, and she's you know, she hasn't been wrestling for a long time, so it's pretty slim pickings. Micah is the member of Donna Del Mundo that I always forget that I'm just like, there's that lady there. I don't know her name or what she does, but she's been in there. She's I don't know what her deal is, but she's there. I think she's kind of new too, but as we both mentioned in the award section, Saida has grown a lot in the past year. I think she's pretty amazing at everything she does for such a young age. She's amazing at like the facial aspect of wrestling, just the moves, everything. And it's amazing how much of it down pat she has already. She just has this amazing charisma about her that she seems like she's going to be a huge star. There's a lot of tit slapping in this match, though. Most of the spots are just a chop fest, and I'm not going to lie, they're both not really great at chops, but at the same time, I don't know, when you're a woman, I don't know how you do this move and not really fuck up a tit. So I think it's like probably a hard move to master when guys have a lot of room there to slap, but women maybe not so much. So there's a lot of that. You know, outside of that, pretty remedial stuff, but there is a little glimmer of maybe a little Ishii inside of Saya Iida. She gives Micah what I believe is a shoot headbutt, which is not a move you see a lot in women's wrestling. You don't see a lot of shoot headbutts being given out in women's wrestling. So again, this is probably not a match you need to watch unless you've never heard of Saya Iida and you want to know what we're talking about. But if you do watch it, stick around for that shoot headbutt, because you're not going to see that too often in a match.
The minute I saw that, I just like thought of Rossi in the back, like, you know, going over his accolades. Like, you guys think shit is sweet with bikini-ing and all the magazines? We got to remind him that's fucking stardom time, and like he just throws in some ghoul shit from time to time to keep people on their toes. Yo, the TV presentation of Stardom, like, I think it might be my favorite thing in wrestling. And how their TV shows are, like, produced, like, it's very bright. It's definitely an upgrade from the matches that are posted on their streaming service, Stardom World. Because on Stardom World, like, they're filmed like a RF video fan cam. And, like, the presentation is, like, really lively. I'm really into it. This clip leads off with a glimpse of catering in Stardom. And I think it's Saki Kashima. She's at the catering table just picking off a beef nigiri from what I presume is from a convenience store, which is pretty sweet. I'm into that. What else do I have here? But yeah, match-wise, I thought it was pretty solid. You know, mainly you're here for Saya Iida showing out, and she does do the Kenta Kobashi machine gun chops into Micah's chest. And she doesn't get, like, full taco meat from Micah's chest, but she's laying it on pretty thick, and, like, it gets pretty red. So if you're into that, you know, it's here. And overall, I thought it was pretty great for the, I'm guessing, like, 9 minutes that they got. So I thought it was a pretty solid match. My first pick of the night was Kenno versus Kazushi Sakuraba. This is from Noah, 12/6/2020. I picked this because there seems to be kind of like a renewal of interest in Noah that kicked off with their 20th anniversary show last month. So I think, you know, I put this match on it, you know, be recent. You know, you try to keep up on things with virtual pros. And I know a lot about Sakuraba, but I don't know much about Kenno, other than the fact that he kind of looks like Dante from Devil May Cry. He does a lot of kicks. And he has to cut his bangs like every 7 hours, I think, because they stop right at his eyebrows every time I see him. So he's very peculiar about that. You know, I know what it means when a wrestler wears a t-shirt to a ring, but I really haven't put it together with what it means when like a guy wears a rash guard to the ring just yet. I don't know if like they're going to be lazy, if they're just going to be like, listen, let's fight for real. I'll figure that one out. But I'm like seeing some pretty cool things during this match. I saw what could be best described as like a grapevine key lock. And there was like a really weird take by Sakuraba on a calf slicer. But I start cracking up towards the end of this match because I know Mike right now is just looking at his phone just mad because... This match just revolves around some guy trying to survive this other person's guard, and it's not that fun to watch. And I agree with Mike. If he's on his phone, I'm not mad at him. And overall, this wasn't for me, and I'm sorry, Mike, for this match.
This was, I don't know if we ever discussed, I mean, we discussed his hair, but it's just, Kano's hair is just like, it looks a lot weirder in pictures when it's not moving. Like if you just see a picture of him, you're like, what the fuck is up with that guy? And when in movement in video, it looks a little more normal, but it's still kind of crazy. But I don't think I've ever mentioned that he's actually in that great Sasuke documentary that was highlighted in episode 3 of Virtual Pros, which I believe is still free on the internet. I can't remember if it's YouTube or Vimeo, but it was free a few months ago. But he's in that. Kino's in that when he was like basically a rookie and he had normal hair, and I can understand why he has the flashy hair now. But like Al said, it seems like really hard to maintain. So hopefully the ladies go wild over this weird hair. The amount of like Al mentioned Stardom's presentation, a lot of graphical shit going on in Stardom's presentation. But Noah's on another level. This was like. If you've ever been a taxi cab in New York City and you watch the TV on there and it's just like 38,000 things on the screen you're supposed to fucking press, it's like that, but it's wrestling.
Dog, this shit looked like the back of like an X-Men card or something for like a little bit. It's like, what the fuck is going on with these grades? I didn't get it.
Yeah, there was definitely a section dedicated to their stats, which is like, I don't know what the stats were. I was going to try and screenshot and translate it, and I was like, I'll just let it go a little. Leave it up to mystery, but yeah, there's a lot going on the screen at certain points. It's pretty wild. I think this was free though, so I get it. You know, it's free. You gotta fit as much in as possible. This starts out before all the submission shit. There starts out as a weird striking match, but they're like doing those open-handed strikes to, I guess, to emphasize speed over power. And it's kind of weird. Like, it's just kind of like guys slapping each other's bellies and stuff, but like real fast to sort of look like punches. It's interesting. It's unique. I don't want to see this all the time, but to see one match of it, it's fine. I thought that was fine. I didn't hate as much as Al said. I think at the end, I don't know what the submission was called, but the submission that Sakuraba does at the end, I think is really cool. I don't know if it's a real submission that anybody could ever do in real life. But I know this isn't what it was supposed to be doing, but it looked like he was giving him like the most horrible Charlie horse, like just like doing some weird shit where he's grabbing his thigh and just fucking just crushing it to the point of just having a full leg of Charlie horse. And I was like, man, that is a fucking devastating submission. But I think all it was really supposed to be doing is fucking up his knee or his calf or something. But it just looked like he was giving him a hell of a Charlie horse, and I was into that. And I thought, I'll spoil it, I guess. It has one of those finishes where it's just like, oh my god, he reversed it into a pin. Those usually don't work for me, but it worked here. I thought that was a pretty cool finish. So I didn't hate this. It's like Al said, it's definitely not my style of shit at all, but for one standalone match, it was fine. I would never want to see more than one of these at once, though. It's, you know, for Noah, again, one of the reasons I always zone out is because a lot of matches are like 40 minutes long, but this was very quick. So it's an interesting match. It's not my favorite, but definitely interesting. I didn't hate watching it. My last one of the night is Christopher Daniels versus Ricky Starks from AEW. Sometime this thing was like middle of the year this year. It's hard. We've done this show for a long time. I don't know if this is the first time Christopher Daniels has been on the mixtape, but he has been a wrestler for many, many years. He's old. He's 50 years old, I think, maybe even older. Somebody really needs to advise this guy about his ring gear, I think. I think he's too old for people to give him advice, and he's just like, fuck you, I've been doing wrestling for fucking 47 years, I don't need your fucking advice. But this dude has had the wackest ring gear for like the past 5 years at least. This look he has here is, I don't know, man, it's not a good one. It's, and he used to have that Nazi jacket, and I don't know. But yeah, this he just looks like the oldest man in his singlet, and I don't even know what to call those pants, like sailor pants, basically.
Didn't Hana Kimura blow him off? Like, I think I read that in the Observer, and like that got her some heat in ROH or something.
Wow.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Bird Bags, but let me know if that's a real story or if I dreamt it.
I can imagine. This old creepy man, she probably don't want to talk to him.
Fuck out of here, Daniel Bro.
I think you know, a lot of people talk shit on the you know, modern mainstream presentation of wrestling camera work and shit because it fucking sucks dicks and people should talk shit about it. But I don't think the AEW turnbuckle cam gets as much credit as it should, because I think it's a good look. They don't rely on it, but they show it when they need to, like once or twice a match, and I think it's pretty cool. So that's a good innovation as far as camera work goes in mainstream wrestling, because it's usually all bad, but I do like the turnbuckle cam. I think Ricky Starks would probably make a very good actor. I think he has that part of wrestling down way beyond his years, where he already seems like a superstar as far as like facials and just like acting, you know, physical acting goes. He's probably at the top of his game, like probably better than most veterans. So I think that's what really shines about him. This match also reminded me how much of, I'm still not really a fan of Taz I am. I know he's kind of turned the corner with a lot of people doing this AEW dark commentary where people sort of like him. It's never going to work on me. I think there's sections of the AEW dark I've watched where his banter with Excalibur is pretty decent, but overall, still don't like the guy. Still don't like his commentary. Ricky Starks' finisher is a spear. This is not a move I really like for small guys to do. Smaller guys. I shouldn't say small guys. I like when some fucking like Rhino does a spear, like some shit like that. I'm not so much into like Edge. Like in Edge, I wouldn't even consider a small guy, but Edge spear, not as much. But Ricky Starks is a very good spear, and he's not even a giant guy, so that's a big compliment from me. Overall, this is a decent TV match. I think they did, you know, this is kind of like the WCW Nitro mid-hour special kind of match where they do some cool moves, but you know, it's nothing you're going to fucking remember forever. But as far as the TV match goes, it was pretty decent.
So I'm on record as saying, like, I'm not an AEW guy at all. I'll watch it from time to time, but it's just not my thing, I think. So I always assumed that Daly's Place was like some sort of cafe or restaurant that like AEW just happened to wrestle nearby. But it's actually just the name of the amphitheater or whatever. So that's just some new information for me to put in my back pocket. I always just assumed it was like a cafe or something. Taz is on the call, which reminded me of like a bit that he used to do while doing commentary for SmackDown. He talked about his friend Joey Numbers. And I think that's always been one of my favorite mystery figures in wrestling, like the mystery GM for Raw. And I know that like I'm putting you on the spot, Mike, but is there like a favorite mystery wrestling personality that you have that was never revealed?
Oh, God, I don't think so. I can't really think of anything like that, no.
I know like AEW is like super into like Easter eggs and shit. Like, and if they did a Joey Numbers thing, I would lose my mind. I usually think it's kind of corny, but if they do it, I'm here for it. But yeah, match-wise, this was pretty fine. Daniels, he busts out a very old man Arabian press, which I dug. And yeah, Ricky Starks is always pretty solid for the most part. And at the end of the match, Ricky Starks, he goes on commentary, and it's revealed by Taz that Ricky Starks, he prefers a hot coffee after every match, and I can't imagine a worse drink to have after exercising. So, like, hearing this, like, made me, like, physically, like, it made me ill, dude. Like, that's gross to have, like, a hot coffee. I'm, like, a cold coffee drinker anyway, so hot coffee is a little weird for me, but I don't know. Like, I remember one time, like, I had OJ after playing, like, full-court basketball, and, like, I wanted to throw up, like, all day. So I can't imagine what coffee would do to me. The last match of the night is my pick, and that's the Road Warriors versus Alexander Otsuka and Muhammad Yone. This is from Battle Arts, Battle Fiction, 11/23/1998. So this clip, it leads off with Hawk and Animal backstage, and I think this is a must-watch alone, just to see Hawk like not giving a shit about his trademark dual mohawks, because like in this clip, he like straight up has like Rod and Todd Flanders hair like backstage, and it's incredible. I've never seen Hawk with a full head of hair in my life, so watch it just for that. Hawk, he tells Japan, yeah, the country of Japan, that he is going to beat up, and I quote, their people. And there was some stink on it, Mike. If this happened in 2020, like, do you think Hawk would have to put out like a notepad apology for this?
I don't know. I think so. Yeah, I think so.
I was on the fence, but I'm leaning towards, yeah, he would probably have to apologize for saying that. So the Road Warriors, they come out after a pretty lengthy entrance by Yone and Otsuka, which involved like an actual guy singing. And one strike on this Road Warriors entrance, no shoulder pads. And second, they run to the ring pretty fast before the ref kicks in for Iron Man, which makes me think like this was like Battle Arts' way of like getting out of paying royalties to Black Sabbath, which is pretty smart, I think, for the most part. But match-wise, it was pretty funny. My highlight of the match was Otsuka revving up to do a tope con hilo to the outside on Hawk, knowing damn well that Hawk, at his old age, was not going to catch this fool. So he was like, I just got to psych myself up to jump into this empty pool. And that's horrifying to think about. And he also does take the Doomsday Device pretty fucking sweet. So overall, this match was pretty fast and fun. And I recommend watching all of it. What'd you think, Mike?
Yeah, this is quite a find. This is a match I never knew would happen. I never even knew fucking Road Warriors were in Battle Arts. This is crazy. This is also, I'm pretty sure this is the same account that had that, this is the Sabu match, or at least it had the Bam Bam Bigelow match and the Terry Gordy match.
That dude is finding gems, so I'm like just going to leech off this guy until like the wheels fall off.
Yeah, there's stuff on this, not like he has interstitial stuff that's not just wrestling, but he has stuff on here that I've actually been looking for Pain Pigs that I just read about that I couldn't find, and he has it. It's just like this weird shit that I read about that I have no other proof it exists. So very coincidental that this guy just popped up, because I think all this stuff has been uploaded fairly recently too. So it's pretty wild. And as Al said, the we are going to beat up your people part. Before that, he also says, Japanese people, get ready, which is, I don't know, man. I don't think you need to say that. But then again, this dude spent you know, days before he was dying going on racist rants on Facebook, and it's just like, maybe all we had to do is look back to this this promo from 1998 and put two and two together that this dude was a little racist. Atsuka and Muhammad Yone are also known as the Love Warriors, which is pretty cool that they're the Love Warriors versus the Road Warriors, and they do get quite the entrance of this man singing. I was like thinking this is a little over the top, but spoiler alert, this match is has a runtime of 4 minutes and 33 seconds, and I think I'm pretty positive they say main evento. So I would be pretty pissed if I went to a wrestling event and the reason I was there, the match was 4 minutes and 33 seconds. So I could see why they added the singer and all this shit going on. It's not like Alexander Otsuka is a household name, and Muhammad Yone, I think he's still going. I think he's still in All Japan, or he pops up, or he, at least in, you know, the past couple of years. I knew Alexander's nickname was the Diet Butcher because it's so fucking cool, but they have their names on the back of their jackets, and I never knew Muhammad Yone at one time was known as Slim Skin, which it's one of the best alternate wrestling nicknames I've ever heard in my life. I don't even know that it sounds like a fucking condom, but it's a great name. Slim Skin. That's that is amazing. So I somebody should inherit that. Somebody should know. Muhammad's not going to mind. Just take Slim Skin. Be known as Slim Skin from now on. Yeah, this match starts, and these guys are two completely different sizes. Like, it's just amazing how different these guys are body wise. Where obviously the Japanese team are—I mean, they're juniors. I guess Muhammad worked his way up to heavyweight, and Alexander is probably on the border at one point. But at this time, they were definite juniors, and they're just like, and fucking the Road Warriors are maximum bloat. Like, these guys are just bloated as fuck, so they're even bigger than usual, and it's just crazy. And yeah, Asuka almost brains himself on that dive. It's just very scary to watch. And this also has, again, if you're not familiar with the Diet Butcher Alexander Otsuka, he does the greatest wrestling move of all time, the giant swing. And this is the saddest giant swing I have ever seen in my life. Like, I don't even know why he attempted this. And I don't know if we are supposed to believe that this was effective and he actually giant swung him, or that he couldn't do it because it's just so bad you can't tell. But, you know, he does a few rotations, so I think we're supposed to think he's doing the giant swing properly, but he just couldn't get him off the ground because this dude fucking outweighs him by 200 pounds. But it is the saddest one. It is not a shock who wins this. There was, like, about 30 seconds where I was like, are they going to let Alexander Otsuka beat the Road Warriors? But it was a quick 30 seconds where I got back to reality. But, yeah, you know, this isn't like the greatest match ever, but as far as weird fucking matches go, this is definitely something I never knew that happened. That is a great piece of history.
That was episode 123 of That World Champion Sound. I had to help my sister move in 2 weeks, so we might be on a little mini break again, Mike. So just letting the fans know that that's going to happen, because I think we were due to record, obviously, bi-weekly. So not happening. Maybe the week after, we'll see.
We'll see.
But other than that, go ahead.
No, that's it. I just said, we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. If you want to participate, email us at virtualpros64@gmail.com. Mike, any last words?
Yeah, check out Pain Pigs on Twitch, on the Virtual Pros Twitch, twitch.tv, VRTL Pros, Monday at 9 p.m. Eastern. 2 hours of wrestling, crazy fucking wrestling, much like the Road Warriors versus Love Warriors, kind of in that vein. So, come out and check that shit out, because it's fun, and It's a good way to forget about our horrible, horrible lives.
We'll see you then.